right. We're going to sing a song called Spoken For. Well, I guess I'm going to sing it, and he's going to help me play it. Take this world from me. Don't need it anymore. For I am finally free. My heart is spoken for. Oh, and I praise you. Covered by your love divine, child of the risen Lord, to hear you say this one's mine, my heart is spoken for. Now I have a peace that I've never known before. I find myself complete. My heart is spoken for. Oh, and I praise you. Oh, and I worship you. Covered by your love divine, child of the risen Lord, to hear you say this one's mine, my heart is spoken for. By the power of the cross, you've taken what was lost and made it fully yours. And I have been redeemed by you who spoke to me. And now I am spoken for. Covered by your love divine, child of the risen Lord, to hear you say this one's mine, my heart is spoken for. Take this world from me. Don't need it anymore.
Well, that's a good song, isn't it? Something worth living for. Amen. Speaks to my heart. All right, it's our opportunity today. We're going to have Brother Roy from Wyndham Christian Academy come. He's the principal of the school there. And we've heard lots of things about this guy, a guy who rules with an iron fist. He has a whip that can reach into sixth grades in no time at all. And the teachers fear and tremble when they see you come. Not really. I hadn't heard any of those things. But I see it when I go over there and I look. I can see the fear in her eyes. Yeah,
exactly. They look real scared, don't they?
They are. They're terrified. You ought to see what they say when you're not here. In fact, we're going to talk about that tonight. We're looking at Proverbs about tongues that wag. But I wouldn't tell you what they said because I'd be wrong. I'd be gossiping. Oh, no, it's our privilege to have him here today. He's coming. He's going to share a little bit about Wyndham Christian Academy. And I ask you to pay attention to the film, the video that we played about being faithful before the service started, because it really leads, it segues into the ministry, Christian schools, and the different things that are ongoing. We really need to, I need to shut up and let him preach. All right, go ahead.
Thank you, Pastor. Well, good morning. First I just have to thank Pastor for giving me this opportunity to stand before you this morning and tell you about Wyndham Christian. But more importantly than that, even, is, and that's that last song spoke to my heart, something worth living for. God has placed in my heart a passion for the thing that he's called me to live for, and that's Christian education. So I want to talk to you more about that this morning. But it is an honor. I sincerely consider it an honor to be with you here this morning. Wyndham Christian Academy has over 20 different churches represented in our student body. And I consider Bible-believing Baptist being right at the top of that list. I know many of you, some on a daily basis, who are in the school, in our church office, in our classrooms. The lovely lady in the middle of the fourth row, that's my wife, Judy. Yeah, raise your hand. Yeah. Be sure to say hello to her afterwards. She's got all kinds of stories to tell. I almost said the third row, but that would have been Heather. And she's lovely, too. All right. But it is an honor to be here, and I sincerely mean that when I say I have the highest regard for Bible-believing Baptists and Pastor Vail, who has been... You have to give a hand to your pastor. He has been faithful more years than I'm aware of. I think he's been faithfully in this pulpit maybe before I was born. I mean, but a long time. Well, you can hear how much they love you, though. So I am here representing Wyndham Christian Academy, and we're a K through high school Christian school where all subjects are taught in the light of God's Word, where biblical worldview is integrated into every aspect of our program. But in anticipating being here this morning, I felt like God had a word for me for you, that he wanted me to affirm you as a body and as individual families, and to encourage you and to exhort you and possibly in some cases to convict you about this subject that I am most passionate about, and that's Christian education. Let me explain it this way. When I say Christian education, I'm not speaking of just Christian schools. Certainly, I include that. But I'm talking about the Christian education that takes place first in our homes and in our churches and everywhere we are. In the home, it takes place during meals and when you're watching television. There's a lot of Christian education that needs to take place when you're watching television. And in church, and that's part of what I love so much about your church, all the activities that you're involved with are opportunities for Christian education to take place. All of the youth events, the announcements we heard this morning of the youth events coming up. And I've heard of the father-son camping trips in the summer. Christian education needs to be taking place there all the time, everywhere we are, whatever we're doing, we need to be about Christian education. We're all responsible for Christian education. The Bible tells us in many, many, many places that God's calling us to it. let me share some scriptures with you. Deuteronomy 6. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments I gave to you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home, and when you walk along the road, and when you lie down, and when you get up. And Jesus himself, when he was confronted and asked the question, you know, teacher, what's the greatest of all commandments? Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets, all of the Old Testament scriptures, hang on these two commandments. And we all know Proverbs. In a Baptist church, I know you all know Proverbs 6:22. Train up your child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not turn from it. And also in Proverbs 3, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight. In the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. That's our school verse. Let your light shine. And finally, in Jeremiah, 29th chapter, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. There are great promises throughout God's word. There are great promises contained in those scriptures, but they all require a response on our part. I've come to the place, last month I turned 65. I'm a senior now, full-fledged, Medicare and everything. I've come to the place in my walk with the Lord where I am convinced that the battle for Christian education, that broad definition that I mentioned already, that the battle for Christian education is what God has placed on my heart to fight. My greatest desire is to be spent for him in that way. I wanted to share with you a little bit of my journey and what it is that has brought me to this place. And to that attitude. I was 25 when I received Christ in my heart. And 3 years later, while living in Maine, I sensed God calling me to work with youth. That was when Judy and I were attending First Baptist Church in Portland. Way back then, the pastor was Pastor John Ludlam. And we entered that church about a month after I was saved. He became my spiritual father and had a tremendous influence on my life. So I sensed that call, and then some 7 years after that, having done youth ministry, some youth ministry in Michigan, and then returning east to go to Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary in Massachusetts, I graduated and earned my master's degree in Christian Ed and Youth Ministry. My wife and I then, with our three children, returned to Maine in 1982. And we didn't really know what the Lord had in store for us, but we sensed that He was leading us back to Maine. It was an interesting year. Our youngest was still preschool, but the others we enrolled into first grade and third grade in the local public school. It was a nice small community school. Our third grader came home one day during the school year and announced that, you know, like you asked, how did school go? And he announced, our teacher told us that we're going to call in the spirits tomorrow. And our eyes got wide, and what exactly, are you sure? You know, and my wife told him, well, if that happens tomorrow, just ask her, tell her that your parents would prefer that you go out in the hall and read your book. And the next day, of course, we're wondering, wonder what happened. He comes home and announces, I finished my book today. And we went, what? And she said, yeah, I was out in the hall while they were calling in the spirits. Well, the fact that he had asked her to go out in the hall had alerted her to the fact that Michelson's may be upset about something. I don't know what this is. Well, there was a Christian teacher in the school, and she went to that Christian teacher and said, do you have any idea why the Michelson's wouldn't have wanted their son in my class while we're, and she went, yes, I think I can. Well, what it was, she had allowed one of the kids in the class to bring in a Ouija board, thinking it was going to be fun, and for the kids to all, you know, experience that. And she was viewing it as just another Milton Bradley game or what have you. So to her credit, she contacted us, apologized, and that was fine, and we, you know, appreciated that and felt like, okay, that's water under the bridge, we'll just move on. Later in that year, our daughter was taking dance classes, and it was taking place at the school, you know, in the afternoon after school. And Judy went in to wait for her and to pick her up when she was done. And she was thirsty and went into the teacher's lounge to where there was a soda machine to get a drink. And there were two people in the lounge sitting at a table across from one another. One of them was one of the teachers in the school. And Judy was in there long enough to get her drink and then leave. But while she was in there, it became quite evident to her what was going on. The teacher was sitting there receiving counsel from the person across the table from her, who was reading her tarot cards. And needless to say, that was another flag going off for us. And we were concerned about that. Now, these teachers that we had gotten to know a little bit were very nice people. We enjoyed them very much. They shared, or seemed to share, much of our values. Yet, we were questioning to ourselves whether we really wanted to place our children on a daily basis in the care of people who were getting their guidance and counsel from such things. So we were concerned about that. And, you know, looking back now, I think we were just kind of navigating, trying to find our way, but clearly, without having a way to articulate it, we were struggling with Christian education. What are our kids exposed to, however subtle it may have seemed? And that was 30 years ago. Things haven't really improved. So it was at that same time that we first encountered Wyndham Christian Academy. School had been open for a couple of years at that point, 2 or 3 years. And we decided, after much prayer, that we would enroll our kindergartner, our second and fourth grader, in the fall. 1 year later, Judy was teaching in the school. And I was working, doing youth ministry part-time for the church. Had an outside construction job full-time. Another year later, and I was also teaching in the school full-time. Still doing youth ministry part-time, but working the school full-time. And we've been there ever since. This board is quite in. Do you do the soft shoe up here, Jeremy? I'm sorry, rabbit trails. All of a sudden I was tapping my foot and I think I should have taps on or something. No, I'm fine. I'm fine. I mean, if I get real nervous, though, you're going to hear my foot go. All during this time, we saw our children thriving in an environment where they were being loved and nurtured by committed Christian teachers, safe and secure, and the confusion was gone. Through the years now, I've watched WCA mature and grow as a Christian educational institution, while at the same time, I've been maturing as a follower of Christ. We both have a long way to go, but what he has accomplished in both of us has been very good. Oh, and our children now are 34, 36, 38. They all graduated from Wyndham Christian Academy. They all went on and graduated from Christian colleges. Our daughter majored in missions and has been to several different countries on short-term missions trips. And at the end of this month, she's returning to Africa again to work with a Christian ministry there. They are working with people that have been rescued from human trafficking. One of our sons went on and got his master's and is working. He's a geologist working in Wyoming, and he's on the board of his church there. And our other son is currently in a master's program for art. So, and I'm very proud of him, and this, along this journey, found this passion for art and what he can communicate through it. So, very proud of them. It turned out well. When they get old, they won't turn from it. Today, Wyndham Christian Academy is a very good Christian school, always striving to improve and get better. And curriculum development in particular, is a vital part of the ongoing process of school improvement. Uh, Our teachers, however, will be, have been, and will be always the core of the curriculum in the school. Their lives. They're the heart. They are always alert to seize what they have come to call holy moments. And I know we've probably all experienced some of those aha moments when we're going through a crisis or we're talking to a friend and somehow God shows up and does something and it's, wow, what? How did that just come about? Well, those happen on almost a daily basis at school, but not always by surprise. They're intentional. The teachers are looking for the opportunities to walk into a circumstance with a student where there can be a holy moment where Jesus actually does something in their life, where he can touch their hearts. Those times usually occur when a child's done something wrong. A couple of stories. Let's see, who can I talk about? I will abstain from any present parties. I'll change the names to protect the innocent. At the elementary level, this was an incident I remember because my involved Judy, my wife. She teaches first grade. And she had a student, little girl, who would come in and, like, when they took prayer requests, she would tell these things. My father's lost his job, you know, and my grandmother just died, and there was always something dramatic happening, and she seemed to be fairly well adjusted. My wife asked the parents about it, and they said, oh, none of those things have happened. And so she took her into another room where they could be alone, and she sat her down, and she could tell, she knew that she was being confronted about something. And she said, I need to talk to you about your, you know, things, these things you've been saying. And so she kind of had this resolve on her face, you know, okay, you're not getting in. And a little stubbornness. And Judy just began to say, now, I know these things are not true, but you need to know how much Jesus loves you and how he's concerned. And as she began to speak to her, the girl melted into tears, and then freedom as God touched her heart and spoke to her, and God's grace came in and took that attitude away. And that girl walked out of that room back into the classroom free. You could feel the freedom about her. And it may have occurred from time to time, but it stopped occurring eventually, and certainly it turned the corner on that issue. Another, an older student, we'll call him Arnold. I don't think anybody would remember him, but there's a chance, so I'm not going to use his name. This was a student in middle school. It was 7th or 8th grade, and his parent came across some messages that he had a girlfriend, not in the school, not from a Christian family, but they connected in the community somewhere, and they intercepted some messages going back and forth between these two. And this young man, all grown up as a youngster, you could see had a real heart, tenderness for the Lord, that brought conviction to adults sometimes because of his love for the Lord. But at this point, difficult age, adolescence, he was pursuing this girlfriend. And one of these messages, he had asked her if she'd have sex with him. Praise the Lord, the parents came across these messages, but the dad was like, I don't know, you know, what to do about this. But there was another member of the family, close relative, that was close to the young man, and he had suggested that, let me talk with him. And so he had an opportunity to sit down and talk with him, and showed him the privilege, or you know, how God had blessed him. And like I said, the boy was sensitive to those things, and the opportunities that he had in the Christian school he was in to minister to others, to go to, you know, nursing homes and other places and minister to people, and pointed out, you make some wrong decisions and you could ruin all of that. Ruin your testimony. No, you really don't want to do that. And the boy was somewhat convicted. Came back to school, and there was a chapel. And the person leading the chapel was talking about, this was junior high and high school, and was talking about being unequally yoked and your need to allow God to lead you to a relationship that he would want you to be in. That boy was primed for that at that point. He ran to that, and they had some materials to hand out at the end of the thing. He ran up to get the materials and thank the person that spoke in the chapel that day. On the way home that day, he got his cell phone out, and he's making a call. And his dad goes, who are you going? Are you calling, or what are you doing? And he says, nothing. I'm calling Sally. I don't know what her name was. Calling Sally. I'm breaking up with my girlfriend. It was God's hand in it in all parts. You see, it's Christian education in the home, in the family, coupled with what was happening at school. The people whose lives we entrust our kids to is important. That's why this church is so important, and the activities. You know, you can send your kids to the activities sponsored by this church with all assurance that when God wants to show up, he's got a vehicle, the leadership in whatever the group is, he has that vehicle to reach out through and touch the hearts of these kids. Now, one more story. This is a former student, a graduate, and it's kind of special to my heart. I coached them in soccer and baseball, and had them in class. And he was a good kid, pretty conscientious, not the, you know, top of the class or anything, but a good, decent student. Same way with athletics and sports. He wasn't the star. He didn't get the MVP awards, you know, the best offensive player awards or anything like that. But over his career, I saw in him qualities that God had placed in him, and I tried to speak those to him, and to encourage him in the faith, and encourage him to continue to use the talents and the abilities that God had given him. Well, as it turned out, back then at the end of the year, one of our sports like banquets, one of the awards that we gave out, our mascot or our name, are the Warriors, you know, Warriors for Christ, Wyndham Christian Warriors. And I had started an award a couple of years prior to that that was called the Warrior Award. And I looked for one student each year that fit all the qualities that we wanted to see in our student athletes, that reflected Christ and exemplified good sportsmanship and teamwork and all of those things. And I gave him the Warrior Award that year. And I thought it was very appropriate for everything that I'd seen in his life. And he appreciated it and thanked me and all of that. Years later, this was years ago now, he's now married, beautiful Christian family. They've got a couple of kids. He's a successful Christian businessman. He's back in the state. Actually, this I came across this on Facebook. And someone on Facebook had posted something about me. And, you know, I'm still not very good with technology. But someone told me, check out this post. And he had commented on the other post. I don't even remember what it was. It was just some statement. I think it was complimentary. But this young man had stated, Mr. Mike holds a special place in my heart for what he gave me while I was at Wyndham Christian Academy. And he said, when I was in my life, I received 2 Warrior Awards. When I was in the service, I received an award. It was the highest award I could get in my unit. And they called it the Warrior Award for what I contributed to my unit. And he said, I never would have gotten that second Warrior Award if I hadn't gotten the first. So, praise God for the work that he's doing in our homes, in our churches, and in our schools, and even the public schools. If you have children or grandchildren, know of folks in the public schools, there are Christians out there. They may be undercover. It's like the church in China. But I encourage you, find them, seek them out, partner with them, hold them up in prayer, because God is working through them in the public sector. An administrator of a great Christian school in Florida. Let's see if I can find it. I heard him, he told me that when he's speaking to the parents in his school, he often tells them, because it's hard. It's a sacrifice. But he often tries to encourage them by telling them, you are doing a wonderful thing for your children at the only time in their life when you can do it, sacrificing for them to be in that environment. And whatever it is, the price is, it's priceless. It's worth the cost to us. To be fully engaged in Christian education in every place, at home, at church, at schools, especially at a school like Wyndham Christian Academy, if you have an opportunity to be there. I'd like to finish with something that that Oswald Chambers taught on. He was talking from John chapter 6, and it's the passage. Well, it's only a few verses. Let me read it. I can find it. It's the passage where many of the disciples, not the 12, but there was a small army of disciples following Jesus around while he was teaching. And it's at the point where many of them stopped following along. And on hearing it, this is verse 60 in John 6. On hearing it, many of his disciples said, "This is a hard teaching. Who can accept it?" Aware that his disciples were grumbling about this, Jesus said to them, "Does this offend you? What if you see the Son of Man ascend to where he was before? The Spirit gives life. The flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you are spirit, and they are life. Yet there are some of you who don't believe." For Jesus had known from the beginning which of them did not believe and who would betray him. He went on to say, "This is why I told you that no one can come to me unless the Father has enabled him." Then this is the verse that Oswald Chambers was talking on, verse 66. From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. And then he asked the 12, "You do not want to leave too, do you?" What Oswald Chambers had to say about this was that they went back from walking with Jesus. They didn't go back to sin. They just relapsed. Meaning, it was getting a little too difficult. And what they had acquired, they were holding on to, but it was like they were stepping back in their own strength. He went on to say, many are spending and are being spent in work for Jesus Christ, but do not walk with him. I can relate to that. I mean, there were the years that I was doing youth ministry, and the early years at Wyndham Christian Academy. I mean, in youth ministry, I was spending my time building relationships so that I could earn the right to be heard by the kids I was trying to minister to. And the same thing happened in school. And once I started teaching school, I found, whoa, this is a lot more effective because I'm with my kids 5 days a week now, instead of a couple of times a week, all day. But I think in those early years, I was being spent for the work of Jesus, but I wasn't necessarily walking with him all the time. I didn't have his presence. In other words, those holy moments they would catch me by surprise, and they would happen. But as I began to learn, and it's only been in the last 10, 12 years that I've really begun to learn what it means to be aware of His presence, be walking with Him, and be intentional about those holy moments. Seeing that door open and walking through that with Him and watching Him do a work in a child's heart. Not anything that I could do. I don't have the words to do it. But I can point the way. And Jesus just presents those opportunities. It's not 12 o'clock yet, so let me tell you a little bit more of my story, my journey. This last part, the last 12, 13 years at school, I became principal of the school in 2001. My predecessor, Mary Zerillo, died suddenly, unexpectedly, the end of August, the week before school was to open. And I had worked closely with her at that point. I was the director of student life, and we did a lot of counseling, and she had me disciplining, doing a lot of the discipline, especially with the guys. And I knew that I needed to fill the void for a time. But at that same time, once the immediate settled down, I came to realize that, wow, the things that I have been questioning and wondering about for the last 2 or 3 years, this is the answer. This is why. I didn't see this coming. But this may be my time. And I was asked to pray about taking on the principalship. And by that time, you know, I was still a little hesitant, but I felt like I knew that that's what I was supposed to do. Just previous to this, for a couple of years, our kids we were empty nesters. Our kids were gone, and we were starting to question, God, what do you have next for us? You know, we'll go to the missions field, or we'll, you know, didn't know. But it just, there was this unsettledness. And I think it was God preparing me to take that next step and become the administrator. But in that process, I've always loved the outdoors. When I was in seminary, a group of seminarians, started a wilderness ministry. And one of my fellow seminarians and I continued that for 20 years, where we were taking youth groups on backpacking, rock climbing trips, and college leadership groups, and father-daughter trips, and father-son trips. And it was awesome. And it has always been, since my first sense that God was real and sensing His presence was in the wilderness, was in the woods. So it was a natural for me. And so in this time, about 13 years ago now, I started feeling like, well, I need to go after God in a way to understand what He wants next for me. And something went back to my childhood. My dad used to love to hike on the Appalachian Trail. He'd spend a couple of days on vacation somewhere, Connecticut or someplace. Grew up in New York. And so I thought, I should hike the trail, be a through hiker, and take extra time to do it. And so I had spoken to the pastor, superintendent of the school, and he agreed that I could take off early one school year, you know, a month early, get started, and I could get to school late the next year and take all the time I wanted to do this. So I started planning this hike on the Appalachian Trail. And then Mary passed, and all this came about. And my sister, God rest her soul, she's my older sister, she's gone on with the Lord now. But while I was wrestling with that decision, one day I get a call from her, and she and her husband were up at their camp in northern Maine, and she'd been hiking that day on the Appalachian Trail. She stopped to sit on a rock and rest, and she said, "You know, I was praying for you, and I felt like the Lord told me to tell you that don't worry about the Appalachian Trail, that the principalship is going to be your trail. The things that you were seeking or hoping to find on the trail, you were going to find, which was a closer walk with Him." And it is true. Over the last 10 years, that has happened. And, I fall back and I flesh out and start getting stressed out or, you know, whatever the case may be, try to take control and take matters in my own hands. But God reminds me, pulls me back and goes, "No, let's, you know, stay the course. Keep walking with me." And it's that ability that's at the heart of Christian education that we all need to be involved with and responsible for. And so when Oswald Chambers is talking about those who relapsed, and they went back from walking with Jesus, not necessarily to sin, but they just relapsed. We can all do that at any point. I equate it to our task, your task, my task of Christian education. Don't fall back. Press on walking with Christ and allowing Him to do the work that He purposed for you to do. We're His workmanship. He created in Christ Jesus. He's equipped us and given us, each of us, talents and abilities that He desires to use as He ministers to one another and to others. It's not just the kids, by the way. The staff have those encounters with one another too. It's a wonderful place to work. And those holy moments, I meant to say, you should talk to Linda Dowdy. She can tell you about holy moments. Pam Cleaves, my wife, they've all experienced them. And it's what we desire more than anything. And so my exhortation to all of us is don't fall back. Walk with Him and allow Him to lead you into everything that He has purpose for you to be about. Pastor, I'd like to ask you to come up and offer a pastoral prayer for us, that we would stay faithful.
Amen. Thank you. He made a comment in the beginning. God placed in my heart a passion for something worth living for. In our prayer today, as we come, we sing, is, Lord, open our eyes. As You open the doors, then open our mouth, and then open hearts. I believe You said be intentional. We said it in our Sunday school hour. Ask God every day, open my eyes to the opportunities set before me. And when we ask, He'll show us. And when he shows us, we won't have to force the doors. They'll open for us. Just like God opened the doors for you, he'll open the doors for us. Let's stand. We're going to pray. We're going to sing a song and give you an opportunity to come and to pray. And the altar will be open. Encourage you to pray. Pray for our families. Pray for our youth. Pray for Christian education. It is under assault. It struggles today just like every place else. The Vineyard Christian School is closing after the end of this year. The world economy has affected the church. Another door is being shut. We pray God keeps the doors open and bless. Let's pray. Father, as we take this time, I ask you, open our eyes to the doors you have opened before each one of us. Help us every day to pray for those open doors. And then, Lord, by your grace, help us to step through them, to open our mouth, to share, or whatever it might be. Lord, lead us. And Father, as we have this hymn of invitation, a time for pause, a time for consideration, we provide the opportunity for others, be it in the pew or here at the altar, to petition you for your grace and provisions and encouragement for those doors that are still open, that you keep them open and meet the needs in this very time. In Jesus' name, amen.